Chinese population and an outdated business model. Delta Council began talking about ways we could have an impact. Delta Council had worked with Dick Cower of Baker Donaldson in the past, and he has worked on most of the major hospital mergers and acquisitions in the recent history of Mississippi. Dick is regarded as the most sought-after hospital attorney and consultant in the country. We discussed the merits of talking to Dick about thoughts he might have on how we might have an impact on these struggling, mostly community-owned hospitals. As we began those discussions, it became obvious that we needed Dick's expertise in the Delta. Delta Council's B.F. Smith Foundation made the commitment to bring Dick to educate and propose steps to address this challenge. I also want to acknowledge our friends at Ceasefire, Cooperative Energy, and their four subsidiaries in the Delta, who are Cahoma Electric, Delta Electric, Twin County, and Yazoo Valley Electric Power Associations, and Skip Graber of the Young Foundation, for stepping up to help the B.F. Smith Foundation support this initiative. After numerous interviews with healthcare providers and private business leaders through the medium of Delta Council, it became obvious that further action was necessary. Because of the cooperation from the Mississippi State Department of Health, including our featured guest, State Health Officer Dr. Dan Edney, Delta Council and Dick Cower joined together with Bose Consulting out of Indianapolis to take the next steps of both engaging and listening to the challenges and opportunities in healthcare in the Delta, with an eye on creating a new regional model that would allow an option for our community-owned hospitals to work together. As we stand gathered here today on November 3rd, this is where we are in the process. I want to stop and acknowledge the leadership of our chairman, Wade Litton, who has led this effort from the beginning, and any progress that the Delta makes on this front will bear his imprint. We also want to acknowledge Delta Regional Authority and the Mississippi Comprehensive Health Insurance Risk Pool through the efforts of our guest speaker and Insurance Commissioner Mike Cheney, who is with us here today, for stepping up to fund phase two of this initiative. But I think Delta Council really agrees that the real star of this effort has been our featured guest this morning. Dr. Dan Edney became State Health Officer in August of 2022 after serving as Deputy State Health Officer and Chief Medical Officer for the agency. Before joining the Mississippi State Department of Health, Dr. Edney was in private practice in Vicksburg for more than 30 years. He received his MD from the University of Mississippi School of Medicine, his residency at the University of Virginia's Internal Medicine Program. He holds board certifications in internal medicine and addiction medicine, and is a fellow of the American College of Physicians. Dr. Eddy has a passion for healthcare, and particularly rural healthcare. Since becoming State Health Officer, he has been to the Delta numerous times and is always willing to engage on better solutions. He and his staff's work with our initiative is what has allowed us to move forward with looking at a new paradigm in healthcare. We can't thank him enough for his leadership and look forward to his remarks and our continued friendship as we tackle this most challenging issue facing the state of Mississippi and the Delta. I might also note he's a native of Greenville, Mississippi, and a graduate of Washington School. Dr. Edney, I'd like to turn the program over to you.
I Ditto what Bubba said, that was my talk, so y'all want to talk about football? Frank, Wade, and Bubba, thank you for this extremely important invitation, and more importantly, the relationship that's been cultivating over the last several months. I'm going to give you a little history. I don't know, have you had the state health officer speak at the Delta Council before? Well, not only am I the first to be blessed with this opportunity, but I'm also the only state health officer from the Delta. And I can promise you, I'm the only state health officer that chopped cotton for 2 summers from Nathan's right across the street. In fact, I credit Mississippi State for really keeping me in the trenches to become a doctor, because if anything needs to get a young man's mind right to stay in school, is chopped cotton in the summertime. But, you know, being a Delta boy, and I want to remind y'all, Hunter and I from Warren County, we're good Vicksburgers, although I think it's my great-grandchild to be the official first Vicksburger. You gotta be third generation. But it's, Warren County is a Delta County. And if you know the history of the Delta, Hunter and I can show you where to turn on Business 61 and go downtown past the old entrance to the National Military Park, and you see the Delta just run right into the Yazoo Diversion Canal, and that's the official terminus. But if you really know anything about the Delta itself, Warren County is just a bump in the road. And you come up those lowest bluffs, and then you stay on 61 towards Natchez, you go right back down, and you move, and then you have South Warren County is as flat as Washington County, and then you run into Claiborne County, and then you run into Jefferson County, and then the true alluvial part, the alluvial plain, disappears. As a state health officer, when I'm talking Delta problems, when I'm thinking Delta problems for health, Warren County, Clayton County, Jefferson County are in there. And it's the same problems, the same resource issues, and we'll need the same solutions. So as a state health officer, I preach that Mississippi is not one entity. We're really 7 distinct regions, and in terms of health, for sure. But my wife is from Corinth, so when we were dating, I kept talking about that she's from the hills, and she didn't understand what that meant, and I had to explain it to her. But I understand the hills are a whole different world from the Delta, and the Delta's a whole different world from the central Mississippi region, or east Mississippi, or you get down to the Pine Belt. We all know the Gulf Coast is its own thing. But don't forget Southwest Mississippi. Southwest Mississippi is very unique and very similar to the Delta. And when I'm looking at strategies and solutions, I'm thinking the Delta counties and the Southwest Mississippi counties really very similarly aligned. Although, they have a different agenda. They have different priorities. But in terms of population health, I'm seeing the same things. So I have to look at the populations of Mississippi and understand that they have different challenges, different resources, and will need different solutions. So our work in the Delta has absolutely totally different strategies than our work in East Mississippi. And I will tell you, most people don't know this, but East Mississippi is pretty close behind the Delta for maternal infant mortality. Now, the Delta gets pounded for a bad outcome. I know the numbers, and East Mississippi, those East Mississippi counties worry me a lot. So, at the health department, our mission is to protect and advance the health, safety, and well-being of everyone in Mississippi. And then I kind of tag on myself with no exceptions. And that, you know, all Mississippians are important. All Mississippians are worthy to be healthy, and they deserve to be able to enjoy life without unnecessary burden of illness and premature death. So what I want to do for you is just, I'm going to show you what you already know. And I was on a call with White House yesterday before driving to Greenville last night, and I told them what I'd be doing today, how important this was. I said, but they're going to know everything I'm talking about. I don't have to convince them there's a problem. I had to convince you there's a problem. And I had to convince folks in Jackson that there's a problem. And that we don't have the luxury of time with these problems. And I have preached at the Capitol since August of last year. I'm seeing dangerous trends with the hospitals in the Delta. And, you know, is anybody here from Greenwood? Okay. So I recognized that we had the hospital issue in Greenwood before August of last year. I was on the job 2 weeks, and I had the city of Jackson water crisis and Greenwood before. And Greenwood before had a sewage leak, which wouldn't let me feel, but we, you know, the reason I'm all up in this is that we license and regulate hospitals. So we had to oversee the evacuation of the hospital and transferring the patients until the hospital could get the sewage leak fixed and we could certify everything was back safe again and let the patients come in. And I thought, I grew up in Greenville. My first job in healthcare, Iris, was volunteering in the ER at Delta Regional when I was in high school. You know, in those days, in the dark ages, you know, Greenville and Greenwood were packed. They were busy, robust, acute care hospitals, truly, you know, what the Delta needed. And then I thought, man, we're gonna be moving 200 patients. Or we're gonna be moving 150 patients. And we moved 12 from an acute care hospital, not a triple access hospital, from an acute care hospital. And that just, as an internist who has been working in a hospital in Vicksburg for over 30 years, it was like, oh, what? And then I just started trying to say, what's going on? And then just what Bubba said, on my own, I started checking in. We regulate the hospitals, they report their census data to us. I was looking around the Delta and it was across the board. I mean, census levels were dangerously low. And I tracked it and saw it was, it wasn't just a one-time event, it was staying low. And knowing the financial challenges that hospitals had coming out of the pandemic, this was very worrisome. And as the regulator was looking into it, where are we with the health of the hospitals in the Delta, I saw it wasn't just Greenwood before. And so I actually had asked for meetings with legislative leadership to brief them on what I was seeing. And not from a judgmental standpoint or a critical standpoint, I was worried because it appeared to me that the hospitals in the Delta were on the edge and were doing all good in a system that was designed for 30 years ago after a worldwide pandemic that obliterated any reserves that they had and drove overhead to ours over 20% higher than where we were in 2018, 2019. So all you business people, imagine, Jim, that ceasefire's over here, it jumps 20% almost overnight, and yet your revenues are flat. And not only are they flat, there's no way to get it up. It's impossible to get it up. there's no business model to get revenue up in the near future. How long do you survive? And not long. And so, I'm having to take legislative leadership from ground zero. Like, they don't even understand how hospitals are funded, much less what pressures they're under. There was this myth that all the hospitals got bazillions of dollars through COVID, and, you know, if you put COVID on a death certificate, you got a bonus payment. You know, that's all, you know, conspiracy theory. I can promise you what Medicare and Medicaid did through the pandemic, they set the rates for the COVID diagnosis, and that's what it was. It doesn't matter if they're there 7 days or 7 weeks, you get the same amount of money, just about. So, it was all this overhead for the protective equipment needed and the expensive drugs and intense ICU support. The hospitals were just pounding, and yet they served you well. I know they did, because we were tracking all the ICU care throughout the state during the COVID years at the health department. And I was watching Delta hospitals like Ringwood LaFleur running 150% capacity in their ICU. And now I know hospitals that were keeping people alive, serving their community. Because there was nowhere else for them to go. Every ICU bed was full. And these Delta hospitals got it done. And they paid the price. And now many of those hospitals no longer even have an ICU. So going from taking care of 20 COVID patients in ICU to not even having one now. And then I started watching service lines drop. Ringwood LaFleur stopped delivering babies. Delta Regional was forced to get up to the NICU. And just one thing after, it wasn't just Delta hospitals, it was really all the local hospitals. But what I saw was that the Delta was further down the road than everybody else. And I told them, Ringwood LaFleur is the canary in the coal mine. Hey, we need to pay attention to what's happening in Ringwood. And I said, they're not alone, but they're going. If they fall, they'll be the first domino to fall. But then others will be falling right behind them. And healthcare access in the Delta was a challenge before the pandemic. So from a public health standpoint, I had great concerns about what, you know, if we were to lose 3 or 4 acute care hospitals in the Delta, what that does to access to emergency care in the Delta, what that does to our systems of care like trauma, stroke, heart attack systems of care, and what that does for obstetrical care in the Delta. But y'all know it's catastrophic for the economy of the Delta. And so this was something that we couldn't just watch and wait. And so I pushed hard that this had to be looked at from a legislative standpoint. We had to consider something to support the hospitals in an emergency fashion until they decide what to do long term. And I have been trying to respectfully educate how funding streams for healthcare in general look in 2023, but specifically for the hospitals. And those of us in the healthcare space know that healthcare is funded at the federal level. Comparatively speaking, state resources in healthcare are fairly limited. They're significant, but they're limited. And you know, the private sector, it depends on what part of the state you're in terms of how much participation there is. We all know the private insurance payments of the Delta are very low. And so that's where the idea of the Hospital Sustainability Grant came about. And I'm really proud that Ringwood received the first check distribution of $1 million a little over a week ago, and got a personal contact from Big Marchand at Ringwood Forward, just how grateful, that little infusion of capital means at a critical time for them. But then advocating for all the hospitals, let's do what we need to do now, but then we need to look at long term. So this is not just a quick fix. There is no such thing as a quick fix for the problems of the hospitals, or even more complicated, the problems of rural health care in Mississippi. So certainly population health of Mississippi Delta is extremely important for me because it's in my blood. And I have family still up in the core Delta, and I still consider myself a Deltan, in Warren County, but very importantly, I have served as a private physician in the South Delta with taking care of Sharkey County, Nassau County, and Missaquena County, and then certainly Clayton and Jefferson to the south. And then even the Louisiana Delta, taking care of those folks. So it's important to me historically, but as a state health officer who is very worried about this data that I'm going to show you, this is why I'm a state health officer and not a private practice physician in Vicksburg anymore. And it was when we got our 2021 Commonwealth report card, and it demonstrated just how poorly we score virtually across the board in health, and then able as a clinician to translate this information into what it means for folks in Rolling Fork, Mississippi, what it means for folks in Cleveland, and Barksdale, and Marks, Mississippi. These are more than just dots on the graph. So what I'm showing you is why I had been talking and preaching and pleading for the last 15 months for decision makers in Jackson to understand where we are and what it means. And now I'm preaching how expensive this is. And so for y'all today, Frank, I want y'all to understand the information I'm going to share with you, how much of a negative impact it has to the economy of Delta, and then to the economy of Mississippi. The Commonwealth Group is a nonprofit public health foundation. They look at four major issues to score how the nation's doing. They look at how well you're achieving just overall health outcomes. So how well are you doing taking care of diabetes, hypertension, reducing stroke, and heart attacks, and all those things? So I can tell you, this city, we do very poorly, mainly because we have at least 200,000, maybe 300,000. If you throw the underinsured, it's more than 300,000. But we have a large segment of our population with no insurance, which means they don't have a medical home, which means they don't have a primary care physician to find out that they have diabetes. I was talking to my cousin this morning, who's been having pain in his feet for 10 years that he'd never seen anything about. He just found out he's diabetic. He's had diabetes for 10 years and didn't know it. And now he has insulin damage. So he's finding out he's diabetic way down the road. And he has nephropathy. He also has diabetic nephropathy. It's in his eyes, it's in his brain. And so just diabetes left unattended for over a decade. And his story is not unique, unfortunately. That leads to more, and same thing for hypertension. The most common symptom for hypertension is nothing. There are people walking around Leland, Mississippi today with a blood pressure of 190 over 110 who feel just fine until they don't. And they have a stroke or whatever. that leads to the excessive number of people on hemodialysis. And these folks all leave the workforce because they become disabled. And then you have 40-year-olds leaving the workforce on disability because of these things. So we score poorly there. They're scored on the percent of your population that are uninsured, and Mississippi has the highest rate of uninsured for ages 18 to 64 in the country. And so we score very poorly there. And then you're scored on access to care. And access to care is tied to insurance, but not solely. And I remind folks, I don't care what your insurance is, if you live in Myersville and it's Queen County, you got more difficult time accessing care than I do in Vicksburg. So, you know, being in a rural state makes access more difficult. Being in a rural state with the lowest number of physicians per capita in the country restricts access. Being in a state whose hospitals are fighting for their life and having to reduce services all over the state, downgrading with the services they can provide to their community, reduces access to care. So women today who are pregnant, who traditionally have delivered in Greenwood, many of them are still delivering Greenwood as an emergency room, which is not what we want, but many of them are having to go to other communities, many of which are leaving the Delta to deliver. So we score poorly there. And then finally, what is the impact of health disparities on your population? And health disparities simply means you look at these populations, and you can look at all kind of populations. We can look at the Caucasian population versus, we can look at the African American population, we can look at our Hispanic population, the Mississippi Band of Choctaws in East Mississippi, and you probably don't know much about the population of the Vietnamese on the Gulf Coast, that there's significant population down here. So I've got all these different populations to work with and monitor, you know. But the one big thing I do, I look at two populations, because it's critically important looking at the outcomes of our studies. I look at the Delta, and I look at non-Delta. And I have to, and I'll explain some of that to you. So when you look at the health outcomes for white Mississippians, yeah, they're far better than for black Mississippians. Black Mississippians do better than Hispanics. Hispanics do better than the Choctaws, you know, and then non-Delta does much better than the Delta population. You can break it down any way you want to, but the differences those health outcomes among different populations means health disparities. So here we go. Here's the scores. Here's Washington, D.C., but they don't count, right? All right. Here's Massachusetts, and then you kind of go through the Northeast and you come down, and all these different dots are different populations within their states based on ethnicity. And this is following me down as we come down. Here is the national median. This is average. This is okay. It's not great, but it's okay. And we keep coming down, 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 down. Now we're into the mostly the southeastern states. Some of the western states are down here with us. Keep coming down, down, down. Here we have West Virginia, Oklahoma. Here's the average. Here's the average for the country. Now we're underwater. And here we are. With the difference between this and this. Look at that, that wide gap between where we are as Mississippians and somewhere in Rhode Island. I point out, typically nationwide, white women score better with health than anybody, and typically black men will score the lowest. In Rhode Island, black men score higher than white women in Mississippi. And here's the white population in Mississippi. Here's where we score, our majority population. Here's average. So the best of us are way below the average of the rest of the country. This is why we have the lowest life expectancy in the country. Instead of 78, we're a little over 71. Y'all, I'm 62. This is important, okay? And as a state health officer, that knocks another 5 years off. So I may not get back to Vicksburg. This is important. This is alarming to me. And here's our black population. The distance between that dot and that dot, can you see it? Equals health disparity. There are reasons why the black population in Mississippi scores very, very low, and whites don't score great, but significantly better, and then Hispanics, Choctaws, Vietnamese are going to be a little bit right in this area. The numbers are too small to show up here. But what this means, this is why we are seeing why we're leading the nation in maternal death. That's not an insurance issue. Every pregnant woman in Mississippi has insurance. They at least have Medicaid, which doesn't do a bad job for obstetrical care. So all of our pregnant moms have insurance. And every hospital in Mississippi will take Medicaid to deliver babies. 60% of our babies live in Mississippi are on Medicaid. 87% of the deaths among pregnant women in Mississippi that are related to pregnancy. This isn't a pregnant woman who gets shot in domestic violence. This is, if she had not been pregnant, she would not have died. And we evaluate all those deaths. 87% of those deaths are Medicaid moms. So that tells me we have a system error. They have insurance, but they're dying at four times the rate of white women. And they're dying way higher than the rest of the country. And none of us want this. And none of us want to lead the nation with the number of babies dying before their first birthday. Nobody wants this. And everybody I talk to, like good folks like you, talk to me afterwards, what do we need to do? And so I'm gonna tell you some of the things that we're doing, and then we just have to keep putting pressure on our elected officials to do what's necessary to reduce the burden of excessive disease and death on Mississippians. So this is real stuff. This is why at the Capitol, when I was testifying, I said we're not just 50th, but 50th by a mile. Because y'all see how that drops? See that? It just falls off the cliff. And I told legislators recently, the only reason we're 50th is because we don't have more than 50 states. If we had 60 states with that score, I know we'd be 60th. So, and this is, and please understand, this is not going to fix itself. And this is not because it's just how it is. I want to remind you that we were 50th in education my whole life, depending on what Arkansas did or did not do. My whole life, 50th. We're not 50th anymore. We're up in the 30s. And that's not good enough. The Lord, it's better to be in 50th. But we decided to invest in the education of our children and to allow education to follow the evidence in terms of education principles for learning, and we have been moving up. So what I have been challenging decision makers in Jackson is, if it worked in education, it will work in health. We're not 50th because we have to be. We're 50th because we choose to be. We're making decisions at a population level that are getting in the way of what it takes for Mississippians across the board, you know, especially low-income Mississippians, but also middle-class Mississippians, what they need so that this dot is closer to this dot. And I'm convinced, as that happens, this diamond's going to keep going up too. And as we go up this way, and it's going to move this way, and we'll move from 60th to 55th, 51st, 49th, 47th, 45th, 30th. I mean, this is not pie in the sky hopes and dreams. This is population health science. If we follow the evidence and invest, we'll get a return on our investment. Now, I'm not talking about throwing money at a problem. I'm talking about making wise strategic investments. What the Delta Council is talking about is a wise strategic investment for the healthcare of the Delta. And from an independent viewpoint, I'm not a member of the Delta Council, you know, they had asked my opinion, and we had met and talked through these issues. Either the Delta communities start pulling together in health and working together, collaborating together, or we're just going to start, these dominoes are going to fall. You know, there's not a large amount of rescue money coming. And Washington has said, you know, the money is available for you, you will do with it as you will, or not do with it. And currently, even as a non-expansion state, we're not taking full advantage of what's available to us, much less to be an expansion state. But you know, my job is to put the options on the table and explain these options as they make decisions. And you know, I can tell you other non-expansion states, like Florida and Texas, are taking advantage of a lot of things that we're not in Medicaid, just regular Medicaid. I think that the enhanced visitor hospital access program that the governor announced recently, that was an example. This is here for us. We can do, if you want it, you can do this and draw the resources down. And I'm convinced that, you know, this time next year, most of our hospitals will be stable and much healthier because of some decisions being made, but not all of them. And the concern I have is, there are three or four hospitals in the Delta that I'm really, really worried about. But as that happens, as these dots merge and shift to the left, then you have fewer people on dialysis. You have more people working. You have fewer diabetics having their right foot amputated. You understand that Mississippi Delta has the highest rate of lower extremity amputations in the nation. Deltans lose their feet at the highest rate of income. That's unacceptable in 2023. And y'all, it's not the folks' fault. Yes, we can all do better. We can all take better care of ourselves, but every time I'm challenged with that at the Capitol, well, it's just personal responsibility. That's an insult to Delta folks. It's an insult to Mississippians. But I tell them, look, I got grandbabies in Alabama. I have to spend time over there to see them. I know the State Health Office of Alabama personally. Alabamans are no more responsible for their health than we are. They're just as irresponsible. But they're way ahead of us in health outcomes, way ahead. So we're not going to blame the folks. You know, it's the system. And what I'm doing at the health department is looking at the system and what can we do to make the system better. So I like to show this, you know, back in the Delta to folks who aren't from the Delta, to remind them, we're talking about a landmass larger than the state of Delaware. And we don't have a NICU. We do not have a neonatal intensive care unit in the Mississippi Delta, anywhere. And you know we're delivering high-risk babies. And if you, and what's critically important with maternal infant outcomes, the high-risk women in pregnancy must deliver at the right place at the right time. Not the closest hospital, but the correct hospital. When you're having a heart attack, you don't want to go to the local critical access hospital. You want to go straight to where you can get the cath lab. Yeah, and the same thing's true for maternal infant. So you know, we are working on programs, and if you watch me, you'll see me intentionally invest in the Delta, because if I can, if we all together can improve things a little bit with Delta outcomes, we think happens to the state's outcomes. It's magnified. So when I look at maternal infant death, the Delta has the highest rate for both. Significantly, it's twice as high as the national average. So we have women dying in pregnancy two times the rate of the national average, babies dying two times the rate. And they're dying at a Delta higher, about 15% higher than non-Delta. Heart attacks, death from heart attacks about 15% higher than the Delta versus non-Delta. I know y'all don't accept that, and I don't accept it. It doesn't have to be that way. There are too many folks outside the Delta that just say, ah, that's the Delta. Delta's always gonna be that way. I said, well, then Mississippi's always gonna be that way. You know, the Delta is a very unique, wonderful, rich community, but it's part of the fabric of Mississippi. And we all have family here. The wonderful people that live here. And we're not just going to write it off. And so the work that we have going is to make things better, not just in the Delta, but in all of Mississippi. And this slide is just to show if we keep doing things the same old way that we've always done, we will get the same old results. The system is perfectly engineered to give us what we're getting today. The hospital systems are perfectly engineered to give us the outcomes we're getting. The primary medical system for primary care is perfectly designed. I mean, what we're getting is because of the system. The high rate of maternal infant death is because of the system that we have currently designed. So it is time to fix the system. And I was taught very early in my medical training, if you focus on the patient, everything else will fall into place. If you're focusing on the patient, everything else is background noise. How much have you heard the discussion centered on the patient these last 2 years? None. Except when my little measly voice person says, yes, we have a hospital situation. It's really important. We have to fix it. But hospitals are useless without patients. They're just a big empty building with high overhead. Hospitals are there to serve their community by serving the patients. And we will never get off the bottom in Mississippi with all these horrible outcomes until all of us have the opportunity to go to the doctor when we need to go to the doctor. And federal law requires access for all for emergency care. But Iris, don't you need folks to be able to get to your outpatient services where the real money is? You know, uninsured. You know, they have to wait until they have a heart attack. You know, they can't have the preventive services. As long as we keep doing that, we will never get these numbers. So we, at the health department, we're thinking through innovation, just looking at doing things differently. Community health workers, we are hiring a lot of them in the Delta. CHWs are just entry-level folks that we train and certify, and they are extensions of us, and they go home, you know, they follow up in the home, they make sure patients get the medicine, they make sure patients go to the specialist, they make sure patients are following the recommendations, and it reduces the cost of healthcare, it improves outcomes across the board. Medicaid, and Medicare don't recognize them in Mississippi yet, but we're working on that, which would be another two for economic development in the Delta, and they will make things better. But let me finish up. Just look at this map. This is what we, this is our investment per capita in public health as a state. You invest in what you care about, correct? You love something, you invest in it. We all love health. And not that any of us want to accept large segments of our community who don't have opportunity for the health that many of us do. You invest in what you care about. And what I'm thinking is that when we invest, we do it based on the data, we do it based on the evidence, we follow other states. It's one advantage to being last, is you can see what other states have done, and what worked and what didn't work. We don't have to reinvent anything, just follow the evidence. And as we strategically invest in health, we will get a return on that investment. We will. And the return on the investment for health is reduction in cost, improved outcomes, and a stronger workforce, and reduction in the impact to our economy. How much do you think patients on dialysis cost the Mississippi economy? How much, when a man has a stroke at 45 and winds up in the nursing home, how much does that cost our economy? When babies die at 6 months, unnecessarily, from preventable causes, how much lost potential over a lifetime? So it's real money, real dollars. We have to factor that into the equation. This is my contact information, and I am happy to interact with any of your folks in the community. I've been honored to be invited to the majority of the Delta communities that have hospitals. I'll be in Clarksdale Monday. This is extremely important to me. The health department can't do it alone. The Delta Council can't do it alone. Greenville can't do it alone. Clarksdale can't do it alone. Cleveland can't. But if we all come together, I absolutely know that we can do that. So just know that you have a partner in the health department. You have a friend in Dan Edney. I will continue to advocate for health care in the Delta at the Capitol. Let me know the needs that you have and how we can partner together. And our role with y'all's good work and whatever you decide to do is to be supportive and helpful, provide the data. And then when you decide what you're going to do, point me in the right direction.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. You said you weren't a member of Delta Council. As president, I'm hereby say that you are a member in good standing. Welcome to the club. Would you be willing for a few questions?
Absolutely.
Maybe if we have a couple, so I'll give the crowd an opportunity to ask a couple of questions if you have them. Did you not plan any questions, Frank?
Obviously not.
Got a question. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I appreciate that, understand that. I will say that 15 months ago, I was kind of a lone voice. And I was talking about the Capitol, not out statewide, just like in Jackson, the decision makers, not anymore. This is getting more and more attention. The level of concern has gone up significantly at the Capitol. Health has been declared the number one priority for the Senate and the House next year. And I've been very proud to have been invited as a resource to answer questions, get the information they need, do whatever I need to do to help them. What we're doing today, we actually started yesterday, attacking social determinants of health that cause these bad numbers. These are things that get in the way of people getting the help they need. Outside of poverty, the number one social determinant is transportation. Y'all well know the delta, the transportation difficulties among so many folks. So the health department, using federal grant money, is now paying to transport folks that are trying to get to the health department. We are paying for that ride to get to us, take them to the drugstore if they need it, and take them home. Now that's just the health department, but it's a start. It's doing something differently. And then that's going to allow me to really kind of reorganize all the health department functions in a way that is more robust, more available to everybody. The commitment I made 15 months ago was the health departments would be access points to the highest level we could, which is why today you can go into the Washington County Health Department and ask to have your blood pressure checked. Don't have to have a point, just come in. Would you check my blood pressure? Would you check my sugar? At no cost, and if it's high, we're going to get them where they need to go. And you know, to try to find the folks in Greenville who need help that don't know it. Those are small things, we add them together. And then also expanding our telehealth capabilities around the state so that folks in rural areas that need access to us, you know, can get it more easily. You know, that's another thing, you know, linking together. The most important thing, though, is for the health department to be part of the solution, to be partners, to provide the resources we have, the expertise that we have, and the access points of the health departments that we have all over the state, especially in the Delta. Can I make an announcement?
Sure.
I made the decision this week.
It's a good one.
It is. Right now, y'all know the health department's been under severe budgetary strain at the state level and since 2017, and there were a lot of cutbacks back then. And we used to have 12 public health districts, now we have three regions. I made the decision, I've been working on it for a while, but I pulled the trigger last week to go to add another region for public health. Region 4 will be made up entirely and specifically of Delta counties. It will be a public health district for the Mississippi Delta, where our full attention will be focused on the public health needs of Delta counties, with its own public health officer, its own public health infrastructure, and reporting straight up to me. So that may be public health nerdism, but that's exciting to me.
Any other questions?
I would just like to ask if there's one message that we could take to our legislators, because now's the time to talk to them. Is there one message in preparing for next year for the legislative session? What one message would you ask us? Because it doesn't matter where we're from, they still got to vote on the issue, correct?
Correct.
So what message could we take? Because we need to be a part of the solution.
Boom, that's it.
Okay, so what message do we, so we're all one voice, what one message would you ask us to take to our legislators?
Access to care for all Mississippians. Notice I'm not defining that.
Correct.
We have options, but it's like one really good option, but there are several options. there are options that we're not thinking about, but pounding access to care. And how's that going to be? The most important thing, though, I'm pleading for the Delta to speak in oneness.
But that should be a right, not a privilege, to me.
There's no argument here. So I'm convinced that if the Delta does what Delta Council is recommending and speaks in one voice in Jackson, you will be heard.
That's right.
It can't be 12 voices or 15 voices. It needs to be one voice. And you know, y'all have the message, you're on track. I commend, y'all have been courageous. You've been ahead of the curve of everybody else in many ways. You coalesce, you have more power than you realize, I think. And, you know, I'm anticipating and wanting to see that power exerted in a meaningful way. Right now, I can't tell if people in Jackson are listening to the Delta, but that's been the conversation I've been having throughout the Delta with healthcare leaders. You've got to come together. However you want to do it, you've got to come together, speak with one voice, work together, and it will serve your people well.
All right, Dr. Eddy.
Thank you. All right,
this concludes our business, and we will stand adjourned. Thank you for your attendance.
Enjoy that. It was a pleasure.